All right, everyone, it looks like we still have a couple more people logging on, but let's go ahead and get started. Thank you so much for joining us today. Our webinar partnering with Gigya to expand your IAM practice into customer IAM. If at any point you have questions during the presentation, go ahead and submit them in the Q&A box, and we will address them at the end of the presentation. The webinar will also be recorded for your convenience, so look out for that. And today's guest speakers, we have Patrick McCue and Suresh, both here at Gigya. So with that being said, Patrick, go ahead and take it away.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for joining, and I do appreciate you taking the time here. For the agenda, what we're really trying to do here, we have started to see in the market a good amount of collaboration with traditional identity access management partners, as well as traditional identity access teams within organizations coming to us and starting to work with us on customer identity management. And with that, we've had some good success in starting to work with a number of partners that traditionally have been focused on internal identity access. And so what we're trying to do is build out our partner team and our partner program with new partners that have those types of relationships that can make the transition or move into both traditional identity as well as customer identity. So that's the purpose of today. And we're going to kind of address that by giving you a brief overview of Gigya as a company, talk a little bit about the evolution of identity as we've seen in the marketplace, and some of the differences that we know are out there from traditional and customer identity, and how you can probably bridge those gaps pretty easily and move over into the customer identity space. And then we're going to talk just briefly on the overview of our solution on how we actually address customer identity, and talk a little bit about how we partner with people as far as going to market jointly together around customer identity. So we'll have a little bit of time at the end for Q&A. We do have a number of people on, so we just ask that you go ahead and put that into your chat box or Q&A box, and we'll address those at the end. So I'm going to take you through the first part here, the overview of Gigya as a company, and then Suresh is going to talk a little bit around the identity space because he comes from that traditional identity area. So Gigya, our company overview, we've had a lot of great growth over the last 4 to 5 years as we've really started to position our technology into customer identity management. And our goal really is to build better relationships with customers by turning kind of unknown digital visitors into known registered users, and then managing that customer record to truly understand and leverage their identity within your organization. We have about 325 employees right now. We're based out of Mountain View, California, but we have offices around the globe and actually have customers in 46 different countries that we work with. So a very global type of footprint, especially if you're working with enterprise customers, this is really important. And our customers span those 46 countries with over 700 enterprise type brands that you guys will recognize. As we progress, we've actually done interaction with 1.5 billion consumers, so very enterprise-rich and heavy-duty system that we have. We've managed over 1.5 billion actual end consumers for our customers. We go to market not really focused in particular verticals, but across verticals. And what you'll see here is a representation of a number of our customers in the verticals that we've seen success. If you look at the top four of those are really the ones where we've had since day one, the biggest success. So media, entertainment, consumer products, e-commerce, and travel and leisure are kind of historically our strong areas. As we start to see kind of the collision, if you will, or the joint go-to-market around traditional identity and customer identity, the others that you see here, education, communications, financial services, and healthcare, really are starting to come into play because those companies tend to have done their employee identification access management, And now they're looking to grow into how do they leverage some of that and actually do that with customers. So we're starting to see a good amount of volume from those verticals as well. So the good news is we don't necessarily focus on particular verticals, but we have use cases and success stories in each of these verticals that we can share with you that you can then take to your customers and talk to them about. So I'm going to turn it over to Suresh to go ahead and talk a little bit around the evolution of identity as we see it and what we're seeing in the market, and then talk a little bit about the differences in customer identity and traditional identity.
Thank you, Patrick, and morning all. So really appreciate you taking the time. What I'll do in the next few slides is I'll walk through what I've seen, what we've seen in the, you know, the identity space in general in the past. And as you can imagine, you know, the whole identity space has always been around the employee and the contractor, you know, management. Essentially, it's about the lifecycle management of those kind of identities. So you have a very clear, you know, join, stay, move, leave cycle. So basically, an employee joins or a contractor joins, and then you have, you know, they stay over a period of time, and as they stay in the system, there's basically things that they look at, which is, how do I request access to a particular application? There's self-service, you know, request and access management that's out there. And then once, you know, they're granted access, there's single sign-on, there's different multi-factor authentication, you know, policies that you actually set up and factors of authentication. And then there's, of course, the federated single sign-on that we've seen. If the business role of the employee changes, you need to kind of reprovision them to certain applications and reprovision access to certain applications, deprovision them from certain other. And, of course, the kind of authentication mechanism that you put in place is slightly different as well. And obviously, when they leave, this is one of the key parts of the cycle, which is essentially, you know, deprovisioning the user, which may be just disabling the user. As you can see, it's like a very clear, you know, cycle that we've been following. And if you think about it, most of these products that were there were on-premise solutions, you know, the folks like IBM, Oracle, back in the days it was Sun and Waveset as well. And what you had was a bunch of solutions that catered, you know, specifically towards employee lifecycle management. Of course, you know, four years back, we started the whole move towards the cloud. If you think about it, the cloud adoption was, you know, different, but not really different from an identity perspective. It was still, you know, you still had on-premise solutions which were doing the heavy lifting for, you know, your ERP solutions and integrations with SAP and so on. But you also had an IAM solution based on the cloud, which was managing access to, say, external applications, more things like Box and Workday and Office 365, Google Apps and the kind. So the motivations were still the same, which is I want to, you know, achieve some level of identity governance. I want to be able to, say, manage and control access to different applications, ensure people have the right level of access, and the least level of privileges, as we call it, right? Then, you know, you still had the single source of truth, which was the HR system. In many cases, you know, reality was it's your Active Directory or some kind of an LDAP where user information is stored. So, you know, the evolution kind of took the internal IAM story partially from, you know, the on-premise to the cloud, but still, you know, a lot of companies were looking at how exactly do I manage these for customers, and invariably it would be, let's just do the authentication, let's extend the authentication, there's no real, you know, process of provisioning and deprovisioning and the kind. Which kind of brings us to what exactly is the customer identity access management. You know, it's kind of the new world order, if you will, because there's no true cycle that we've seen with employees where, you know, they join, they stay, they move, they leave, right? You really don't have that kind of a cycle in the real sense. It's more a customer journey. Initially, customers come in, they stay around for a bit, there's some, you know, they prefer anonymity because you've not really delivered any kind of value to them, and as you deliver value, you know, basically they start saying, okay, let me share some basic information with you because I've got some value. I want to get better out of what I've, or out of my visit to this digital property. And when that happens, you know, that's when they actually start revealing something about themselves. So as you can see, there's no true, you know, source of, you know, truth in this case. It's, you know, it's just that customers going from unknown to known. Right, and the way they go from unknown to known is an establishment, a process of establishment of trust. And once they get to be known and they like you, they basically start engaging with your brand and your property across different channels. And subsequently, they start participating. They become you know, once they're delighted with your product, they actually start becoming an advocate of your product. So there are multiple different ways in which this actually could happen. It could be through social networks, it could be directly on your website, it could be directly on the channel, and the kind. So the motivations and the way the customer identity lifecycle in this case works is, you know, slightly different. People may leave, but you don't really pull them out of the system, right? It's no deletion of the identity. They may come back at any point if you have something to offer. So the way the system works is completely different from, you know, what we've actually seen in the employee IAM solutions. So I'm hearing some echo. If you guys can go on mute, please. So, you know, what exactly are some of the differences between traditional and customer identity? Let's just get into some of the key changes there. So if you look at the employee IAM, the scope and scale is completely different compared to the one for customer IAM. You know, typically you're looking at internal employees, the constituents, and, you know, basically not looking at customers, except in the case of, say, single sign-on or access management in some instances. Was there something? I'm sorry. I heard a... Okay. So, you know, you're managing typically in the, you know, thousands of employees, in rare instances going about to 100 plus thousand, maybe a million if you include some contractors and if you're looking at, you know, some of the SSO solutions that are out there. So scope in the case of customer IAM is, you know, basically entirely different. You're starting pretty much in the millions. You know, in the case of employee IAM, your maximum you would go up to is maybe a few millions. So what we are looking at here is, you know, the scale of the system being so different that you need to kind of architect it appropriately and in such a way that it actually is something that you can, you know, manage for peak loads. The second thing is the kind of data stores. You know, you basically have, you know, traditionally directories and maybe relational databases in certain products that actually are, that use, that basically store data. The second part is, you know, the kind of structure that you have to the data is well established, and it's not going to change, you know, enormously over the life cycle. So you will have an OU kind of an organizational unit, as in the case of a directory, and then you have different child nodes. So it's hierarchical, it's well defined. But when you compare and contrast that with a customer IAM, there are certain elements that are structured. You still will have the first name, last name, email address, and the kind. But in reality, you could get data sources, multiple different data sources, pushing in data in multiple formats, which essentially means that the kind of data structure that you need is going to be very different. To kind of put this in perspective, if you look at an employee IAM solution, because it's in a directory or a database, you define the schema once, and the schema doesn't change that often. And even if it does, you kind of push it out. But in the case of customer IAM, the schemas can change rapidly, dynamically, which essentially means that the kind of repository that you use needs to have some kind of a dynamic schema mechanism and can actually scale to billions, you know, in most cases. So when you start looking at those kind of, the kind of attributes that you store, they're, you know, fundamentally different. The identity sources and the user experience is a huge, you know, is a huge difference here again. In the case of employees, you as an, as part of IT, as you as the person who's actually implementing the solution, have certain, you know, you have certain leeway in terms of defining what the user experience is going to look like. You know, employees can be told this is the first place they need to go in and start requesting access. But in the case of customers, that really doesn't work. You know, you can define for employees, here are the kind of devices that that we support. You can put some restrictions on where they're going to come in from and what kind of access they can request. Now, there's always an authoritative source of truth, you know, which is either a HR system that's synchronized with, and, you know, some database or directory, or in many cases, many organizations, and AD tends to be like this, you know, real source of truth, if you will. So when you start looking at, you know, comparing this and contrasting this with customer IAM, the reality is you have customers who are coming in basically from an unknown perspective. You don't know who they are. There's no real single source of truth. And which means that the customer IAM solution that you put in place will become the real source of truth, because that's the first place that you're going to capture information. The second thing is, from a user experience perspective, you know, you cannot define to customers which are the kind of devices they're going to come in from and they're going to use. You can't, you cannot say, hey, I'll support you only if you're coming in from an Android device or an iOS, or if you're using this kind of a browser. So obviously they're going to come in from a variety of different sources and of using a variety of different devices, which essentially means that, you know, you've got to accommodate all of this as part of your, you know, deployment. The third thing is, you know, because of the way the custom IAM solutions work, you may have to customize it per region. You may have to customize it per brand. You may have to customize it per line of business. So there's a huge bunch of, you know, support work that actually goes into making rollouts for either lines of business or geographies or different brands. So obviously the user experience with each of those is dependent on the kind of constituents, which means the kind of solution that you put in place has to take that into consideration. Then there's the performance. As you can see, you know, most employee IAM solutions are actually optimized for security, which means, yes, if I have to balance between security and user experience, I always go with greater security, greater protections, ensuring this, you know, that auditing controls are actually put in place, that my segregation of duties are in place and the kind. So obviously performance, you know, kind of is defined more from a security perspective than from, you know, user experience perspective, which means this, you know, obviously because of the kind of processes that employees are opened up to, they have a much higher tolerance in terms of how, you know, what kind of experience they have with the application. However, you know, with customer IAM solutions, it's completely optimized for user experience. That doesn't mean the need for security goes away. The need for security stays. In fact, it's going to be higher because at this point, if there's any breach, it's much, much more visible and brand, you know, brand impacting. So obviously, you need to balance security. You need to maintain the same level of security, but you need to have enough flexibility and optimize for user experience. And there's very little, you know, latency in terms of, you know, from a user's perspective, in terms of, you know, them being able to access the applications. If you have an application that takes forever to load, you know, obviously people just go away from it. They don't come back. And you spent all the marketing dollars to, you know, let them know about your brand. Experience is bad. They go away. And that's kind of another thing that you need to keep in mind. And the one of the key areas is, you know, looking at post-login preferences, because if the user is asked for 10 fields during registration, they'll just go away. You know, it's kind of, you know, something that they won't put up with. But, you know, with customers. But when you actually have things that you can progressively build the user's identity profile and you have the hooks to do that, it makes it much, much more valuable for them and, you know, makes it a much more engaging experience. And then, you know, the kind of access, you know, as I mentioned, you basically have the ability to say there is the, here are the kind of devices that I support, the applications that I support, and all of that can be limited to a specific, you know, set of users in the case of employee IAM, which is very different in the case of custom IAM. Your solution not only needs to be optimized for multiple devices, multiple platforms, multiple geographies, it's best suited if you actually have an open architecture that is flexible, that is, you know, that people can actually leverage rapidly and build their own applications on top of your identity platform. And obviously there's the volume, variety, and the velocity of the different interactions and the kind of experiences that they actually provide. And privileges and permissions, if you think about it, the authorization aspects of identity and access management is basically based on business roles, and it's the system of least privileges. In the case of customers, that's really not true. I mean, I'm not okay if I give an employee administrative access to an application, but I'm absolutely okay if I give a customer who's at, say, a silver level, platinum level access, because I'm actually, you know, they probably get experiences, they probably will engage with you better, and they probably will have greater brand loyalty. So obviously, you know, there's complete differences. And the final part is the way users actually register, authenticate, and the self-service. In the case of employees, it's a very, you know, rigorous process that is actually initiated and driven entirely by an IT provisioning of the user. It's based on single source of truth, as we said, and it's, you know, user self-service is based on IT policies. It's completely different in the case of customers because they may come in from multiple sources. They may choose to register on your site. They may choose to use social login. They may actually come in and just browse as an unknown user and decide to come back later and just register at a different point in time. And you should have any of these self-service you know, whether it's a password reset, it's a multi-factor authentication, all of this enabled for from a customer experience perspective. So as you can see, there's like significantly large differences between customer and employee IAM. And, you know, there are, as people who are deploying this, you'll also notice that the kind of integrations that you have, both from a back end and from the front end, is going to be very different. And that's really where the significant services that are required, because the kind of back end integrations that you're looking at from an employee IAM solution is typically for an ERP solution, a HRMS solution, the kind. But here, you're looking at actually merging customer data into various different downstream marketing applications. It could be an MDM, it could land up being some kind of a data management platform, an email service provider, some kind of personalization engines, and so on. So the kind of integrations and services that customers require are going to be very interestingly different, but are, you know, they focus entirely on the customer's identity. So with that, I'll kind of hand it back to Patrick to go over some of the other content that we have today.
Great. Thanks, Suresh. And I do see that we've got some questions coming in, and we definitely will get to those. So we will make sure we've got time here at the end to jump in that. So we've given you a little overview of the company. We've talked a little bit about how we view the differences in customer identity management versus traditional identity access, especially as it relates to pure employees. Now what we want to do is just go over a little bit around how we view a customer's identity, the value of the identity, and the business challenges of how we're solving a problem for the customer, and then talk a little bit about the product itself. This will be very high level, and one of our goals coming out of this will be that there is an interest on both sides to move forward and partner. And then we can obviously do a much broader, deeper dive into the technology, the implementation, the hours, where you can actually make money. So we will definitely set up those sessions if there's an interest. So I think different than the employee identity is what Suresh has kind of talked about, is the customer identity is evolving over the course of time. And it's important not just to authenticate and to make sure that people are secured and make sure they are who they say they are, which we do, but also to start storing this data of the customer and making sure you have a true identity of that customer. And so the way we view this is that there's a lot of different types of data that are relevant to an end customer of yours. And obviously, first and foremost is that registration data. So we run that entire registration process in the cloud and can store that data. And obviously, each customer can build out what they want to see in that registration data itself. But in addition to that, it's important to have on one record, one identity, a lot of other information, such as system data. So what is the device ID? What is the time of day that they log in? You know, where is their geolocation? What have they opted in or out of as far as things they want to see on the site or emails they want to get, et cetera? All that system type of data is very important to get a view of who this end customer truly is. In addition to that, it's also important to have behavioral data. So how did they get to the site? What did they do on the site? How many views did they make on the app? How many times have they actually shared something maybe from the site or from the application? Have they put comments or reviews in on what's going on the site or your products or your services? So all of that's also very important to really build out the true identity of that particular customer. And then in addition to that, there's a lot of rich first-party data that you can gather off of social networks if they decide to register or log in with a social identity. So, for example, from Facebook, you can get the birth date. You can get a list of their likes or their things that they have interests in, those types of things. So you can get all of that data and combine that to create one true identity of your customer. And this goes a lot farther than traditional registration systems or email systems, because in most cases, if you sign up for an email, pretty much all you're giving them is an email address and your name. you're not giving them this other rich data that's necessary to really be able to ensure that we as a company know who you as the customer actually is. So we kind of view that as the true identity of a customer, and it's all-encompassing. And then in addition to that, what we've seen is the market dynamics are really starting to drive people to actually adopt customer identity, and they're doing it in a different way than they did in the past. I, along with Suresh and others, were at the Gartner event this past week, and one of the things we started to see a lot of is people that were in the traditional identity group, if you will, at a customer or prospect, are now being combined with the marketing people that are responsible for the identity of the customers, and that's being put into one group. So traditionally what we've seen, right, is that CIO has been really making these technology decisions, where now the organizational structure is demanding that the product officer and the marketing officer and those types are also involved in defining what's important for identity for the customers. Obviously, one of the drivers that we've seen, and I think you can see this across most different products in the actual software world, is a lot of on-premise type of systems are now moving to the cloud. And we are 100% cloud software as a service. So we are starting to really see an uptick in that where people are saying, hey, we've got a system in place, but it's here on an old technology. We want to upgrade and we want to do that in the cloud. In addition to that, and Suresh has kind of touched on this, is traditionally, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, people either came into the store to find out about your product, your service, those types of things, or they did it through the website. And that was pretty easy to manage because you could do cookies, you could do things to that effect, you could do a loyalty program where they had a card, so you kind of got an idea of who they are. Well, that's changing tremendously because now your customers are on social media. They're coming through mobile applications. There's actually a number of our customers that have connected customer identity into the Internet of Things. All these technologies have different ways of logging and tracking who that particular individual is. And with our solution, you don't have to worry about which way they're coming in one day versus the next. We can handle all of those. In addition to that, what you'll see is a lot of companies out there spend a lot of money on third-party data. So what we mean by third-party is they're going out to a company and buying data about consumers and trying to make assumptions on who I am when I visit a site based on that third-party data. Well, what we've really started to see is that data, A, is very expensive, but it's become very outdated over the course of time, in addition to the whole reduction of cookies and the way that you can collect data and what you can collect. So our goal is to really get customers that first-party, unstructured data that's out there about the customer and store and manage that data for them. And then obviously a really big one, as this whole thing has started to explode around identity, is regulation used to be fairly limited on what you could collect, how you could collect it, what you could do with it. That changes every day now, and it's very complex, not only from a governance standpoint of regions or countries, but also if you're using social networks, the requirements that they have changes on a pretty regular basis. So that's driving people to want to outsource this type of thing to somebody that knows about those regulations and has their business basically keeping updated with all of that compliance and governance, which is very important to these customers. So this is kind of what we're seeing. And what we've done is created a platform that allows you to address these needs. And it's the customer identity platform that we actually have. And so you can see here that we break it really into three main components. And we call it connect, collect, and convert. And the connection piece is really where you're making that direct connection with the customer. The collection is where you're actually taking that data, that information of that customer identity, and storing and managing it. And then the convert portion is where you're actually leveraging that data to do something in your business. And that's very important because all of this really leads up to making a return on investment by leveraging the data that you're collecting about this customer. So when you look at Connect, the products that we really focus on there are twofold. So one is, as you can see from the screen, the lower left-hand area there is kind of a visual of what our console looks like in order to create a registration page. And you can go in and customize this as much or as little as you would like to for each customer. And there's a lot of different things and tasks you can put in here, such as, hey, if you know they register, we want to send them an email welcoming them. All of that can be done here in this console, and you actually define what that's going to look like and how it's going to work. And the beauty of our system is once you've done that with our registration as a service, you actually can represent that across multiple devices so that there's a similar look and feel, and then you can have single sign-on across all of those devices without someone having to remember passwords for the different devices or different sites that you may have. So a large organization like the Coca-Cola company obviously has hundreds and hundreds of sites based on products. They could actually leverage this technology to go across with one single sign-on all of those sites. And in addition to that, as you see on the Red Bull site on the right-hand side there, we actually have built integration to about 38 of the leading social networks globally. This allows for a consumer to come and not have to fill out a registration page, but simply go ahead and register using that social network credentials. So you can come into a site the first time, you can click on a button and say, just register me with Facebook. The adoption of this is huge and taking off, especially in the mobile world that we're starting to see. Nobody wants to go in and fill out a registration page on their actual cell phone. So this is the technology that we have brought to the table for that. And we manage all of those, make sure that we keep all of those up to date for our customers so that they don't have to go out and do any development work to actually make that connection and have that on their actual site as part of the registration process. In addition to that, one of the things, especially companies like a consumer goods company or a financial services company, they really have to have ways to make people want to come to their site. Obviously, if you're an e-commerce site and someone's coming to buy something, or if you're a travel site and someone's coming to book something, it's pretty easy to get them to come to your site because that's one avenue or way that they actually sell to the consumers. With a consumer goods company that doesn't actually sell necessarily directly to an end customer, they want to have a site that people will want to come to, that they'll want to spend time on. And so we have a core set of projects that allow you to come in and define around your site to get people to register. So for example, you could share your thoughts. So we have the social share capability. You can go in and use the share bar, as I'm sure everybody's used at some point, to say, share this on my Facebook page or share this on my Twitter account, etc. They can come in and have immediate reactions. You can have an activity feed of what's going on, allowing people to make comments on certain things, ratings and reviews. All of this is part of our core platform that you can add on based on what the customer wants in order to make that site more useful and make that connection. In addition to that, we have our own loyalty, or what some people call gamification, which is basically on a digital property, the ability to kind of score points, to measure points, to give people badges or different levels based on what they're doing on the site. And we manage all of that piece as well. So our goal is to make your digital property something people want to not only come to, they want to spend time on it, and they're willing to register in order to have access to the content or some of the other capabilities that we offer there. So once you make that connection and someone comes in and registers, what we do is we manage that entire profile and we manage that in the cloud. So we have a completely unstructured database that we have designed that sits in the cloud and allows us to manage that particular profile or that particular customer identity. Now we have data centers across the globe, some of which we manage 100% on our own, some of which we leverage AWS to manage. And what we take care of here is all of the security, all of the compliance, everything that's necessary to keep those records up to date. So in other words, if I come in and say I want to opt out, or I close my Facebook account, or I want to be deleted, we can manage all of that through our system automatically, as well as the users have access, our users have access to go in and make changes to that data. So for example, if a call center agent picks up a phone and there's a misspelling or a wrong phone number or something in that record, they can physically go in and change that as well. So all of that profile management is handled by us, and the customer doesn't have to worry about duplication of records, et cetera. We'll make sure we take care of all that. And then lastly, once you have all this data, so once you build this database and you have real insight into your customers, we have a tool, it's a soft BI, if you will, that sits on top of our database that marketers or users can actually go in and leverage to start to glean information about their customers and the data that they've collected. So for example, you can go in easily and say, you know, show me the split in ages of all of my registered users. Show me geographically where my users are heavy. Show me the top TV shows that my users may have in common. And you can start to see trends based on that that allow you to make decisions about how you go and interact and work with those particular partners, customers. In addition to that, we have built out a very strong set of integrations, which we call our identity exchange. And these are integrations that we've pre-built with systems that customers use in their back end. So for example, if you want to create a segmentation of your data and then use an email system to actually send emails to that segmentation, we have integrations into the top email systems. We have integrations into the top DMPs. We have integrations into the top analytics organizations out there. So once you get the data, what you do with it to actually drive business decisions is a huge competitive differentiator. And this is where we're seeing huge adoption by some of our largest customers and where we're getting the best case studies and success stories, if you will, because these people are now able to leverage data that they never used to have access to better work with their customers. So that's the brief overview on our actual solution. And what I wanted to do is talk a little bit about our partner program and what we're looking to do and how we're working with our partners. So first and foremost, it's important to understand that we have a huge commitment as an organization to work with partners, and that hasn't changed over the last 2 to 3 years. It's always been a focus of ours. What we tended to see initially was when we reached out to companies that are similar in nature to what you all would do around identity, the timing wasn't great. In other words, people would say, well, we're already partnered with an identity partner. We don't really need another one. And I think there was the thought process that maybe those partners would actually come up with this type of solution. What we're starting to see now is a big influx of people coming to us that have done traditional identity access management, because now they need a solution for their customers because their customers are coming to them and their current partners don't necessarily have that. The beauty of working with us is we've been partner focused and friendly since day one. And so this is just a great evolution for us to start adopting new types of partners. Our partner program is really built with three main partner types. We have a number of technology partners, so companies that have complementary technology. We do that with very large organizations like Adobe, IBM, Salesforce.com, etc., as well as some niche players that have very focused solutions that we can work with, like Rich Relevance or MyBuys, those types of things, where we can actually have offerings for our customers because we tend to be a piece of a larger project or ecosystem that's actually happening. So we have a number of technology partners. Then the ones that are probably more relevant for you all is our solution provider or our SI implementation partnerships. Our solution providers really are focused around collaboratively working with us, having us as a key component to solutions that they're delivering, and doing that in the way of either referral to us on opportunities or actually reselling our technology to end customers. Most of our partners that are in that solution provider category also would be an implementation partner. And these SI and implementation partners is where we want to fulfill about 30% of all of our services by leveraging partners. And so we want to make sure that when we have a project that we sell, we have a set of partners that we can go to fulfill those services needs. So that's normally the implementation partner is going to be someone that's also a solution provider and collaborating and working with us in the actual sales cycles. We've built the program out to be very flexible so that you don't get locked in to just one piece of the way to go to market. In other words, what that means is if you sign our solution provider agreement and you want to resell, you can. If you sign our solution provider agreement and sometimes just want to refer to us or just work on projects, you can do that as well. So it's very flexible the way that we've built out the program, not locking you into only one way to go to market. In addition to that, there's a huge investment from us into the partner program. So every one of our partners has a channel manager and an account manager that's assigned to work with them. The channel manager is going to work with you around new opportunities and selling, getting you enabled, making sure you have everything you need to be successful. Well, the account manager is going to work with you to make sure all of your customers are successful and making sure that you have all the access to things you need in order to make sure that that customer is satisfied and referenceable. In addition to that, as part of our program, we've invested in what we call market development funds. So we do joint activities with our partners in the field in order to generate new opportunities for both us and the partners. So we help fund those types of events. And those can be webinars, those can be trade shows, those can be executive breakfast, those types of things. We're very flexible in doing that when we build the plan. In addition to that, we're implementing partner relationship management. It's a module of Salesforce, which will allow you not only to log your own opportunities and make changes within our Salesforce instance, it's also going to allow you to get access to all of the content that is relevant for you to be successful in sales, marketing, and in implementing your customers. So all of that will be housed in our Salesforce version, which you will have access to. We also do all of the enablement and education directly to you without a cost. So that's both in sales enablement, solution enablement, as well as implementation enablement. So those are all pieces of the puzzle of what we're doing around going to market with our partners. We've got about 50 partners globally right now, and as I mentioned, we have started to see a number of traditional identity players come and start working with us. And that is, we probably have four or five of those that we've signed over the last 2 to 3 months. So we do feel that there's a big enough synergy here to help you leverage our technology and build a practice in customer identity management, both in new customers as well as your current customer base. So obviously, we'll follow up with you to see what that interest level is from each of your organizations. But in addition to that, if you have any questions or you want to schedule something quickly to kind of have that deeper dive, that next level, Teresa Lee, who's listed here, is someone that you can reach out to, and she works on my team, and she'll make sure we get you the right resources to kind of come forward and start having that discussion. So now I know we've got some questions, so I'm going to turn it over to Maria to go ahead and pick some of these. I think we've probably got too many to go through and answer all of them verbally. It looks like Suresh has answered some directly here, but Maria, you want to take it over and kind of read them out loud so we can share with the group some of these?
Yeah, absolutely. And there's actually two or three good ones that Suresh answered, so I want him to address it. Again, out loud for the audience. So one of those questions came from Krishna, and it says, do you distinguish between acquired customer versus a potential customer? For example, a car company has customers who bought cars and potential customers who are looking to buy a car.
Yes. So basically, as I was mentioning, there are two different ways to look at it, right? It's a two-part question. One is, I have a known user that's already part of my internal applications, and then there's the unknown user who's probably just visiting. You don't know when somebody comes into your website whether or not they actually are an existing customer who's looking to buy something else. So under those circumstances, there are, what we do is we look at the user experience for the user, and we look at what point can we actually ask them to register or let us know about themselves? For example, if they choose to register using, say, you know, something on the site by just providing a first name, last name, and an email address, then what we do is we also have partnerships, like what Patrick mentioned, is their technology partners with whom we actually have integrated, where we go back and look at internal applications and figure out, is there some kind of a user identity that matches up with this user? And if so, we can actually help build a complete single profile. So the first part of the question is, you know, is there a known user? And is there, and how do we bring the user from being an unknown to a known user? That's exactly how we do it. So we simplify the registration process so that they can become known faster. And once they're known, we actually integrate with internal applications to get a full 360-degree view of the customer.
Great. And then another question that came through. Suresh, what are your thoughts on a recent report by Gartner on the evolution of modern identity?
Yep. So the interesting thing is, you know, as Patrick mentioned, we literally are coming off the Gartner IAM show this past week. So we had it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And, you know, Gartner talks about the evolution of identity being bimodal. This is in the same way as their bimodal IT model that they're talking about, which is, you know, they're going to be, your IAM program is going to run at two paces. One is, which is, you know, very traditional identity, which is focused on, you know, employees, which is focused on making sure segregation of duty and access certifications and access requests and the kind are all tightened up, which means it's not at a, you know, significant pace. There's not much. The rate of change in that is actually not much. And then there's the second one, which is pretty agile. You know, it's moving at a rapid pace. Things are changing rapidly. And so they basically are advising, you know, their IT execs that be aware that there is a bimodal IT that's actually IAM program that you need to put in place. However, they're not, you know, what they are saying is they need to be, you know, two separate programs, although they have not yet made a recommendation on whether or not they should be two separate products. And our belief, you know, is that given, and we went through some of the technical differences here, our belief is that, you know, it's probably two separate products. And in fact, one of the things that we've seen from our conversations with Gartner is they're saying that over a period of time, there's probably a move that's going to happen where even employee IAM is going to be managed in a very similar manner to, say, customer IAM. So, you know, basically because of consumerization of IT, right? So that's the interesting thing that we've seen about the Gartner IAM, you know, the report, the evolution of identity report that they actually mentioned. And by the way, there's also a second report that they're going to come out with, which focuses on actually managing customer identities. And that's expected in the next few weeks. I'd really, you know, encourage you to take a look at it when it comes out.
Great, thank you. And then we had one more question here, and says, "Hi, Suresh, how does this fit into a CI/CD DevOps IAM Microsoft services model?"
Yeah, so it's microservices. So here's the interesting thing: if you look at the customer identity, space. Because of the rate at which things are changing, you want to be able to get as many services as possible. And when I talk about services, you know, there are two different kinds of services that you could talk about. One is the REST-based services that have been exposed. The other is composable, decomposable microservices. That's an architecture that's kind of evolving. Now, the interesting thing is, you know, if you look at most of these solutions that are out there, what they've done is these are historical solutions that were built in the last 10, 15 years. For example, you take, I used to be at Sun and then at Oracle. Both the stacks there are actually, you know, pretty much written in-house based on SOAP, and they now have a REST API kind of, you know, covering the whole shell, if you will, acting as a shell to the whole set of products. Now, that's kind of one way of doing it, but what we feel is if you actually have built your architecture in a composable manner, REST first, number one. The second thing is ideally microservices, which is the emerging architecture that's coming up now, and, you know, where you can deploy on Docker and stuff like that to make it easier to go from, you know, dev to prod to QA, and then, dev to QA to prod, then that's an emerging, architecture that's coming up. So the key thing is, when you're using folks like us, which is a cloud-based solution, a lot of the key functionality that you need for IAM is actually exposed by us as, you know, as close to as you can get in the microservices model, because we are REST first. Now that enables you to actually start building applications on top of us, and, you know, by just using composable and decomposable services from us. So it absolutely plays into what we are seeing as emerging architecture.
Great. And then it looks like we have one more question here, and this might be more towards Patrick. What are you doing around sales and delivery in Latin America?
Oh, so great question. So as I said, we do have operations and customers in 46 different countries. We have taken an approach of working exclusively with partners in two of those regions, one of which is Latin America. So we are focused 100% in working with partners in that area, both for sales and for delivery. So if you specifically have an interest in going to market in Latin America, we would love to talk to you, especially if you have operations in Brazil, Mexico, or Chile or Colombia. Those are our main focuses. It doesn't mean we wouldn't work in Argentina or Venezuela, but we tend to see those as lagging as far as their adoption of customer identity, as well as with their economies right now being very difficult to sell in that environment. But again, my team handles all of that. So again, you could follow up with Teresa, and I've got a guy that runs Latin America, but it is 100% channels focused. We don't even have direct salespeople in that area. We do have a number of customers there. However, it's one of our fastest growing regions, so we'd love to talk to you on that.
Great. And then this will be the final question. Are you working on an on-premise solution?
No, our goal is not to go on-premise, and the reason being is that right now we have a very proprietary database that we really need to maintain and partition off for the customers. So our goal is to remain a SaaS company in the cloud. If you have specific requirements that would, require that, we could obviously take a look at that, but right now it's not in our product roadmap.
All right, great. Thank you so much, Patrick and Suresh, and thank you as well to the audience members. Again, as Patrick mentioned, if you do have any follow-up questions or would like a deeper dive, I do have Teresa Lee's contact info on the Contact Us widget down below, but her email address is once again going to be teresa.lee@gigya-inc.com, and that's gigya-inc.com. And you can also email me at webinars@gigya.com, and I can forward appropriately to Teresa. And again, thank you everyone for your time, and Patrick and Thresh, thanks for taking the time to speak with us today.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it. Take care.